Okay, so we are at 2:03. I'm going to get us started because we have a lot of ground to cover. Again, this is the combined criminal and civil breakout session. But before we get started, I want to make a shout out to the vice chair, soon to be chair of the LRCC, Roger Townsend. Will you please stand? What you're seeing here today is Roger Townsend's brainchild. And I'm only standing here because I was supposed to head up the criminal breakout session and he the civil. And he said, hey, why don't we combine forces? And I said, absolutely. So he should actually be standing here. But I have the honor of introducing to you our moderators who will then introduce our judicial panel. So the moderators are from the Western District of Washington. I know these two people personally. They are at the top of their game in the state of Washington. We have Robert Flanaugh II from the law offices of Robert Flanaugh. Bob, would you like to come up? He is a top criminal defense lawyer with ample trial experience and also I have the honor of calling him a past co-counsel. Yep. And then his co-moderator is one of our top plaintiff civil litigators at Faux, Cochran, Vertitas, and Amala in Tacoma, Washington, part of the south end of our Western District of Washington, and that is Tom Vertitas.
Thanks, Cynthia.
Thanks, Cynthia. And in fairness, Roger should be very nervous because he mildly agreed to give a criminal defense attorney and a plaintiff's attorney 90 minutes with a microphone. So he doesn't think it can be done, but we're going to try to do it. We are both very excited to be here as moderators today on a very important topic, empaneling a jury. And what's really unique about this is we're bringing both the civil and criminal aspects together. So over the next 90 minutes, what we're going to try to do is give you the survey data that 69 of you kindly gave back to us. And then we're going to try to get the wisdom from these three jurists, who we'll introduce in a moment. And then we're going to have an interactive session where we'll get together in groups. And that's what Cynthia was asking for you guys to pull in close, because we're going to spend about a half an hour getting the collective wisdom of our audience. And then the last 20 minutes, we're going to have a little Q&A or commenting back and forth. So we're going to try to do a lot in 90 minutes. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to invite Bob to introduce our three amazing panelists. Bob?
And it's funny because I know all of these, I know two of the three judges very, very well. One I get the pleasure just to meet, which is Judge Anthony Battaglia. He's a senior United States District Court judge from the Southern District of California. He's a former magistrate judge and came from private practice. Mm-hmm. We have Judge Jill Otake, who I know as, she's smiling at me, a classmate. She did a little bit better in med school. Yeah. a classmate, University of Washington School of Law. She's a district court judge. She was a former United States assistant attorney and a county prosecutor. So I know she has a lot of trial experience, and we have a lot of good questions for her. And last, we have Judge Marsha Pechman, who I've had the honor of trying cases in front of in both state court and in federal court. She's the past chief judge from the Western District of Washington, former county judge, and also was in private practice, and did a little dabbling through his clinic. So those are our judges. So give them a round of applause, and we'll get going.
Thanks, Robert. So a little bit of a timeline so we can use our time effectively. This is our agenda for today. So we're going to start off by talking about the results of the survey. 69 of you were kind enough to respond back with a lot of candor. And what we're going to do is take about 10 minutes to go over the feedback that the 69 participants of the survey gave back. 44 judges responded, 22 attorneys, and three court officers responded back. And what we learned from the survey, we'll go through a few of these, but one of the questions that was asked was, what are the most frequent missteps you see attorneys make in jury selection? And Robert and I are going to take turns going through this, but what I wanted to highlight for you here is when you look at this, what you see very clearly is everyone agrees in the, what is it, the fifth category there, attorneys that talk too much aren't effective. And what you find here is that over 50% of the participants, close to 60%, found that lawyers talking too much in this process are not effective. Interestingly, focusing too much on the people that you want, attorneys found that to be very ineffective, and being too argumentative was another factor. Robert, do you want to hit the second one?
And I know what you guys are thinking, which is there's nothing better after lunch than data and graphs. I know you're holding yourself back, so we'll go through this next one. Now, look at this underappreciated technique you have used or seen effectively in jury selection by attorneys. I'm not going to read all of them. You can read them below. Look at the attorneys and what they like. Right? Allow more attorney voir dire, 60%. Spending less time rehabilitating jurors who should not be rehabilitated. I give attorneys credit for realizing that, 60%. Now look at the judges. Kind of boring. Jurors agreeing on a neutral statement of the case. Now, I agree that's underappreciated. And as, I'll tell you, as a defense attorney, I shake. Because whenever there's the neutral statement, defendant was found with 30 kilos of drugs in the back of his car, but he didn't know it was there. I know I have a long, long trial, and it's not going to be any fun.
Before we go off to the next topic, I wanted to see if we could have the brave judge that commented on the fourth question who actually said they want to defer more to the lawyers in the voir dire process. I'd like to see that brave judge raise their hand. There was one.
He may not.
There was one brave judge.
So look at the delta, though. The attorneys say allow more attorney voir dire, but look at what the judges say. I mean, that's the legal result. Only 10%. So I know what some of you are thinking. Well, I'm an attorney. I'm different. Of course judges want to hear me, and jurors do too. Well, before you think that, the judges double down. When you look at the lowest for judges in that delta, for deferring, it's zero. There was no negative button, or I think they would have put it there. So remember Hamilton. What did Aaron Burr say? Speak less, talk less, smile more. I think there's a pattern, and I think you'll see it next. Go ahead.
The question was asked about what federal judges do differently during jury selection, what they'd like to see. And the attorneys, shockingly, wanted more time and wanted the judges to do a little less rehabilitation.
Supplemental questionnaires. Not really earth-shaking. Attorneys, yes, over 50%. Judges, yes, over 30%. I actually kind of agree with this one because a lot of it says depends, which makes sense. If it's a small marijuana case, you may not have a questionnaire. If you have like a sexual assault case, you're definitely going to want to have a questionnaire. Now, I say that, but again, look at what some of the judges said. There is 10% who said it's never appropriate to have a questionnaire. So we'll talk later on about the tension between judges and attorneys and why they think that's so.
We got feedback with regards to jury consultants. Fairly expected. They may be helpful in the appropriate case. I think the attorneys and the judges agreed on that. Robert?
I mean, unconscious bias, attorneys and judges look like they agree.
You were then asked about what specific aspects of jury selection would you want discussed in this forum. And I just want to hit these very quickly. These were the responses that the participants gave. Ooh. Trying to get the judges more involved in addressing hot button topics, not giving so much pressure to the attorneys to talk about issues such as social justice, bias, or some of the sensitive topics that are raised in today's times. Trying to create a dialogue with jurors that will encourage them to speak up. Too many times lawyers are asking broad questions and maybe the judge helping out and trying to get some conversation going. There was a resistance by judges to allow attorney voir dire. We've talked about that. And then there was a discussion about whether supplemental questionnaires could be used in every district. That was discussed. And then there was one brave soul that said, granting for cause avoids retrials. It's a very thoughtful comment that maybe we'll ask the judges in a moment. But this leads us to one of the most important parts of the breakout session, and that is getting the collective wisdom from our three jurists. And what we're going to do is the first topic that we're going to give to the judges to discuss is going to be explained by Robert. Robert, do you want to go ahead?
Sure. Well, the tensions between the objectives of lawyers and judges in jury selection. First of all, I guess the question is the premise. Judge Battaglia, what is the objective of the judges? What do you think the objective of the jury is? I'm sorry, of the attorneys are?
Well, I think that's where the tension is, and there's another undercurrent, which is time limits, which affects everything. But the tension really is that the judges have control, whether it's Rule 24 on the criminal side or 47. On the civil, it's in the hands of the judge to decide if the lawyers can ask questions, what follow-up, what proper questions they can ask. And there's an inherent tension there that we all have to deal with. And time limits really inform that whole debate, that tension, because we're putting a time limit on the case, giving the jury an expectation of how long, and some of those incremental parts need to be controlled.
Judge Pechman, what do you think? Do you agree with that, or do you slightly disagree?
Oh, I agree with the judge that that's a major issue. But, you know, my job as a judge is to seat a fair jury that is as diverse as we can find them, that is capable of reviewing the evidence, and that's my job. Now, I view the lawyer's job as differently. They're trying to pick the best people for their side, and I understand that. But along with Judge Battaglia, I would say that it's not only time, it's money. Every time we call in a jury pool, in my district, it costs about $4,000 a day. And I need to know that what you're doing with those jurors is worth that to the public, if in fact, in the end, we're going to agree on most of the people who are selected.
Judge Otake, what do you think?
It feels like voir dire.
It does, a little bit. I'm going to start moving around.
What do you think, you're number five?
Exactly.
I will say this. So I joined the bench, it'll be 5 years ago next week, and one of the things that, you know, as an AUSA, as a trial attorney, I always thought was that, well, voir dire is really for me and for us, for the parties, to select folks. And I, as a judge, I realized that I'm now become like this, have this mama bear instinct for my jurors. And so that's why time matters. It matters not only because it's money, but because the jurors are making a huge sacrifice to come to your courtroom. A lot of them don't want to be there. I think as lawyers, we all wish we were on a jury. Most of the public doesn't want to be on a jury. And when they're coming into your courtroom, you suddenly, as a judge, feel very responsible for them and their time and protecting them. And so I think that's one of the tensions, is that on the one hand, you're thinking, as an attorney, or at least I did, they're here for me and this case, and it's all about us. And then as a judge, that's, you're really not thinking in that context at all.
You know, Jill, they don't want to be on the jury until they've done it, and then amazingly, yeah, they love it. It is the best civics lesson you can ever give the members of the public.
They do love it, but they don't want to have it take forever. I've been surveying juries for 30 years, and I'll pick a garden variety jury in 2 hours, and the feedback I'll get is, why did that take so long? So, you know, you're damned if you do, damned if you don't. So, but, you know, we do need to give them a good experience, need to be respectful of their time. And, you know, the Judge Peckham hit it on the nail. We're looking for the fair and impartial cross-section of the community, and you want people that are going to vote for you. And that's okay, but that's where the tension lies.
And I can't tell you how many people have come up. Has anyone seen the show Jury Duty?
Yes.
Yeah, people got half out. I can't tell you how many people come up and go, is that what it's really like? being on a jury? And then I've actually heard from judge friends who've said, people will use excuses from the show. Like, it'll be like a DUI, and they'll say, oh, DUI, I don't want to have to stay in the hotel for a DUI. Like, they think they're going to get sequestered. Like, no, you're not getting sequestered for a two-day DUI.
So let me throw one in here, Robert. So from the feedback that we got from the survey, one of the tensions I see are that the lawyers want more time, and the judges might not think that all the time is necessary. And I wanted each one of you to have an opportunity to add your feelings on that.
Well, I think that's the inherent problem. But many of us, myself included, suggest you submit questions for us to include in our portion of the debate, use the questionnaires. You can get a lot of input if you use it. And one thing, and it may not fit necessarily here, but one of the things lawyers like to do is, you know, talk about the importance of the civic duty of jury service and go through that civics lesson, not realizing the jury's already seen a half-hour movie that's already said that. And I would venture to guess not all of you have seen the jury orientation videos in your districts, and you should, because you sometimes say things that are inconsistent with the video. That's why the jury thinks it's repetitive. They hear it in jury orientation, judge will touch on it, and then here you come with your civic speech. And that's part of the problem. You haven't understood the universe you're operating in because you've not done some of that early work.
So my understanding is that also some attorneys are frustrated because they can't pick a jury at all. It's done completely by judges. Judge Pechman, what's your practice?
Oh, I set different time limits always with the lawyers. They always get to pick the jury. And I set time limits based upon whether the case has got drug, sex, and rock and roll. Right. I mean, do you have something that's going to be really important, hot button, for people to talk about and that you are particularly interested in? But when I hear lawyers say, I want more time, judge, you know, I say, careful what you wish for. There are not many lawyers who can sustain what I usually standard 20, 20, 10, 10. Sometimes it'll be 45, 45, 15, 15. It is hard work to do voir dire. And most of us are good journeymen. There are few of us who are great at it. So when I hear somebody tell me they want more time, I'm willing to do that, but I need to know what you're going to do with it. So the burden's on you.
So let me ask, I like that, so let me ask Judge Otake. Here's my question, though, real quick.
Okay.
I want you to put on your attorney hat.
Okay.
I'm going in front of Judge Battaglia. I'm going to suppose that he does not at all like attorney jury selection. What should I say to him to convince him to give me a shot?
I think you focus on the things that Judge Pechman asked. You focus on the sex, the drugs, the rock and roll, right? I mean, you say, Judge, with all due respect, this case involves a lot of really sensitive hot button issues. These are what they are. I think it would be unfair to my client if we weren't able to address them. If you want to address them, Judge, you know, I'd happily give you a list of questions if you're willing to consider that. I think that's how I would approach it.
Judge Battaglia, what do you think?
Well, I would agree. I think we need specifics. And in the civil arena with the joint neutral statement, you know, the more robust that is, not only helps communicate to the jury what the case is about, but it sort of calls out the need for more time to look at the hot buttons that are all throughout that statement. So the more you put into that, I think the more time you're going to get to explore what will be the push button issues in the case.
Tom, you want to move on to the next?
Before we do, I wanted to ask Judge Pechman particularly because I've had the pleasure of trying a case in front of you, and one of the things that I was really impressed with is how you connect with the potential jurors, and even when a juror is seated, you encourage them to talk, and you talk about the democratic process, and you get everyone in that courtroom invested in the process, which I think lowers the temperature in the room for everyone. And I just wanted to ask, do you think that's your role as a jurist, or how do you feel about that?
I think it's, excuse me, courtrooms are for juries in the sense that we're putting on the show for them. And we need to make them feel welcomed. We need to make them feel comfortable. We need to educate them as to why they're there. So yeah, I do wrap the flag in it. I talk about our forefathers and who died for this privilege. And I also don't ask for excuses until after we've gone through the voir dire process, because I'm convinced that it cuts down on the number of people who want to flee, because now they become invested in our story. So I do think it's part of my role to basically say, you're the most important people in the room, save for the litigants that are here today. And we're here to do a honest job of presenting the facts to you.
Our next question was from the group that gave feedback on the survey was the role that jury consultants have during jury selection. And I wanted to ask if anyone had any strong comments on whether you think it's appropriate. We live in a day and age now where you have Facebook, social media, AI, jury consultants that are getting very, very key pieces of information about folks that are just coming in to sit as a prospective juror. And I wanted to ask, as a judge, how do you feel about that? And do you think that's improved the jury selection process, if so?
Who do you want to start with?
Well, Judge, it looks like you're batting leadoff here, so.
She's looking at me, I'm thinking, okay, I guess that's my cue. Well, I think it's important that you are informed. I think we all understand that there are limits to how intrusive you can become in your not friending, you shouldn't be doing that. You'll get very little time in many districts to really do that kind of work, because you'll get the panel list as the trial starts that morning in my district. But to the extent that you can do it and not slow down the process, you should reach out with the tools you have.
Judge Otake?
I don't have a strong opinion on this one way or the other, because honestly, I have always worked for the government and have been never able to employ one. But I don't see a harm in it if you have the resource for it. But I also think that sometimes as attorneys, we forget to follow our instincts on some of these things, and that's something that we should try to always keep in mind.
Judge Pechman, I know from prior discussions, you have an interesting perspective with regards to what you can learn from jurors and the role of juror consultants. Can you let us know?
Not worth warm spit. That jury consultants do what you as good lawyers need to know, and that is how to read people. And so when I see jury consultants, it's very interesting to me, because I usually call out my law clerks who have no trial experience. And I ask them to go through who you would take off. I also ask them who it is that's going to be the foreperson. They can usually nail it every time. And they're not a fancy jury consultant. Also, when you come to me with your fee applications and you're charging $800, $900, $1,000 an hour, I actually think that this being able to read people should be part of your wheelhouse already. So if you want to spend your clients' money that way, fine. But I haven't seen it make a whit of difference.
We move into the use of questionnaires. And by just by a show of hands, how many districts, does everyone employ questionnaires for their jury selection process? Is there anyone that doesn't? Okay. I just wanted to get a sense from all three of you. Do you use questionnaires, and do you give lawyers enough time to absorb the information that they're given? And I just wanted to ask, because I do a fair amount of work that involves sexual abuse, and you can get onto some really sensitive issues, and it really struck me where you're asking people to talk about some of their most personal and really sensitive information, and then they get excused, and then they're off into, you know, they go back into the public, and you don't know what you've done. You might have triggered them. So I wanted to get your sense on just the use of questionnaires and kind of how you handle some of those sensitive topics. And maybe Judge Otake, you could start.
You know, I start to rethink this recently because of a conversation that Judge Simon actually, comment he made at one of our conference planning committee meetings about that very issue, about re-traumatizing survivors. By asking them these sorts of questions, and I thought he had very good advice on it that I plan on using, which is to, you know, obviously the, if you're going to have a questionnaire on a sexual assault case, explain that this is a case about sexual assault and just ask some standard questions and then end it with, is there anything else about your life history that you think it would be important for the attorneys to know? And instead of asking them, you know, directly asking them, are you a victim of sexual assault? Are you, have any family members who are victims of sexual assault? And, you know, it, and then I do would definitely leave it up to the attorneys during the selection process to follow up on that, you know, maybe ask more pointed questions or ask me to ask more pointed questions or even do individualized one-on-one voir dire. Questionnaires in general, I think, are very helpful. In our district, we use them a great deal for hardships, and that takes out a lot of time. That takes a lot of the extra time spent during the selection process of trying to figure out who can actually be there for 2 weeks. And that's the attorneys get that information way in advance, and we have a hearing on it way in advance, and it's very helpful.
I'd agree with all of that. We use them for 2 week or more trials for the time hardship excuse, and in the civil arena, they're ideal, particularly when you've got large local employers. We in San Diego have Qualcomm, and people own stock, or their cousin or brother or mother work there, and you can ferret out a lot of those obvious cause issues before they hit the courthouse steps and save a bit on the overall jury cost. And with those very sensitive issues, yeah, they're a good way to tee them up and then give you a chance to handle them privately at sidebar or separate session if you need.
Well, I have a just quick question on that. Same thing I asked earlier. We have attorneys who are frustrated because there's 10% of your colleagues who think it's never appropriate to use a questionnaire. If I'm arguing in front of you, Judge Pechman, saying I need a questionnaire because of this kind of case, what should I say to you?
Well, first of all, I think you need to come to me with a plan of what it is you want to ask and what you want to get at. Because I see lawyers who come in who say, well, here's my questionnaire, Judge, and I look at it, and I know it came off the Washington trial lawyer's website. It wasn't tailored for this particular case, or it came off of ABOTA or some other organization because they haven't tailored it. They haven't thought out actually what they're going to do with it either or how fast they can do it. Do they want us to call in somebody a day ahead of time, call in all the jurors a day ahead of time? Because, you know, how do you know who's filling out the form? How long do you want to send it to your jury consultants so that they can look everybody up on Twitter, Facebook, to do research. So you need to come to me with a plan about the practical side, and need to come to me with a plan for exactly what you want to find out. We don't have many sexual assaults in federal court, you know, except for pornography, we rarely run into those issues. That's much more of a state court issue, and I think that the judges in the state court have particular problems. But can I tell the one story about Alice?
Sure.
Okay. I tried
to be gentle.
Okay. I tried a case in state court. It was a very serious criminal case. The parties wanted a questionnaire. And I did a questionnaire, and one of the fatal flaws in jury selection was that nobody talked to juror number 16. She wound up in the box just by elimination. That happens more than you'd like to see. So it's a very brutal murder. And I noticed that this particular juror is curled up in her seat, and she's watching the autopsy photos like this. And the next morning, a woman arrives in my chambers and she says, I'm juror number 16's sister. I can't believe that she got picked. And I said, why do you say that? She says, well, because I filled out the questionnaire. My sister has the mental capacity of about a six-year-old, and I'm the one who takes care of all of her concerns, and she lives with me. I immediately have to tell the lawyers, One side wants to keep Alice, the other side doesn't want to keep Alice. The wise judge basically says, you have to be 18 in order to be a juror. I have enough factual background to tell me that this is not somebody who has adult capacity to absorb the material. I excuse Alice. Immediately she turns to me and says, what did I do wrong? What did I do wrong? She starts to cry. Then the jurors came out and wanted to know, what did I do with Alice? So questionnaires can be great, but there are practical problems to them, and we sometimes use checking the boxes or assumptions about, on the scale of 1 to 10, where do you fall, that you're really going to accurately understand who your juror is.
The other problem with questionnaires, the practical one, is a big burden on the clerk's office and the time lag you need to order to get the questionnaires back and so forth. So when you come to me and ask for the questionnaire, I'm going to be thinking about, is it worth all the lead up time for that, or are these questions we could better ask with the people right in the box? So there's going to be that delta involved in the decision making. But sexual assault, excessive force is an issue now that is so prevalent, trust or lack thereof in law enforcement. In a big wrongful death case, that can be a real good issue for a questionnaire to get the venom, the heat out of the courtroom for the rest of the veneer, I found.
Yeah, and boy, is that an area that has changed.
It sure has.
It used to be that police officers got the advantage. I don't think that's the case anymore.
So, neutral statement of the case, Bob. I know that you always have concerns about it. You cry in your beer to me about it. All of you, when you're getting ready to pick a potential jury, have probably a neutral statement of the case. What are your feelings about your comfort level of giving the neutral statement? I know that one of my greatest concerns is this might be the first comment that is coming from the bench as to the case, and everyone thinks that's gospel. And how hard is it for you as a judge to craft something that truly is quote unquote neutral?
I don't craft it. I have the attorneys craft it. And so I have them meet and confer and agree on it. And obviously they don't always agree, but if they don't, then that's where, that's like what I get paid to do, is make decisions on those things. But if you get their buy-in and their collaboration on it, I think it becomes less of a challenge. And at least in our district, the attorneys have done a really good job of working together on that.
Yeah, I do the same thing. I have the lawyers to try to come to an agreement, and I often edit. When they can't agree on, we have the two versions. But I think it's extremely important in giving the jury a baseline of information and facilitating the discussion to follow. I don't use them in criminal cases. I think simply reading from the indictment or explaining the elements of the charge using a model jury instruction is much more neutral. It can be, you don't want to encourage the defense to disclose their theory necessarily too soon, because sometimes that's an evolution in the case, not a hard concrete concept at the beginning. But in the civil, certainly they're extremely helpful.
Judge Pechman, any thoughts?
Yeah, I don't know how you can expect to call people in, ask them questions about their background, their private life, their family members, and not tell them why it is they're there and what this case is about. So, I think it's only courteous to basically tell them what it is, why we're asking these questions, and also let them know why we want to have this conversation. You know, why in the world are you asking me about my family's drug problems? You know, why would you ask that? Well, if it's a drug case, now they understand. Or why would you ask me about, whether I've ever been injured to the point that I couldn't do my job? Well, if it's a tort case and somebody is a quadriplegic, now they understand why it is you want to know. So I think the neutral statement is really critical. I think that lawyers can collaborate on that. Unfortunately, I don't see many lawyers who think of that as one of the first things they need to do. You know, they do it at the last minute. That's what you ought to be thinking about when the client comes in to sign you up, is what it is that you're going to say about them and their case from the beginning. So I use them all the time. If I don't get one I like, I write one I like.
One of our most important topic questions is, what are your strategies and techniques? I'll start off, and then Bob, you can keep us going on this, but what are some of the effective techniques that you've seen from the bench?
Are you picking on me again? Okay, I thought you said Judge Otake. Some of the most effective, well, listen. You don't listen. You know, I ask all these questions, we get all these answers, and then you get up and you ask a question like it's something brand new, we went over it 20 minutes ago, and then you get an answer, but you're so fixated on the next question, you don't follow up. So listening is key. It is the less is more. And you know, using the, you're not going to get a chance in most federal courts to talk to each and every juror and become their buddy, right? It's just not going to happen. But you can utilize, you know, a juror who gives you a particular either good or problematic answer, and then pose to the whole panel. Do you agree with juror one? You disagree, and you can start to then get a better sense for what everyone feels. But you do have to, you know, listen to make that follow-up, knowing it's a good question. One of the things that I find, because I do a fairly elaborate voir dire myself, usually with questions you've given me, in addition to my own, but there will be 12 jurors out of the pack. They're extremely vocal and are always raising their hands, right? And then there is that silent minority, the deadly ones, that you never learn anything about. And when you get up to ask your questions, you go for those vocal ones, right? The one that made the outrageous statement, you want to dig in. But you sometimes then ignore those that haven't said diddly. And they can be, they're probably going to be your jurors, right? Because no one's going to strike them. We don't know anything. Well, looks okay. I don't know. So don't overlook. I mean, those that give you an answer and you know they're out of here, that cause is pretty clear or peremptorily, they're gone. Work on the ones you don't know. We ignore them, we colloquially speaking, or the big we ignore them too much, those that just lie in wait for you.
I would say, just in terms of style, and I'm stating the obvious, but I also know how difficult this is to have a conversation rather than, you know, a very kind of, let me ask you, juror number 15, blah, blah, blah. The jurors, as a judge, you can see immediately, very quickly, like within the first 3 to 5 minutes of voir dire, the attorneys that are liked by the jurors. And it's because they're the ones who are having conversations. They're not, you know, asking these stilted, awkward questions. So that's my first piece of advice is style. Work on that. Try it at cocktail parties. Number two is actually ask questions. If you have a chance to read a transcript of your last voir dire, I recommend that you do it. And you look at how much talking you did before you actually asked a question. That is something that I've found to be a very consistent flaw in the attorneys that appear in front of me, is that they're usually standing up, and I think it's nervousness, and I understand that, I get that you're coming in, you're nervous, you just want to speak because you just want to get that out of your mouth, but what you're doing is you're not actually asking questions. And so if you take the time to just, you know, think carefully about what are your first few words going to be? You know, shouldn't be more than a sentence or two, and then really get to asking questions.
Judge Beckman?
I've got two quick stories to illustrate the two points I would want to make. Is first, you have to listen to the answers that you're getting and follow up on them. I was watching a voir dire, very boring old style voir dire, where the general question was, have you ever been the victim of a crime? And most of the jurors raised their hands. So She reversed it, said, who's never been the victim of a crime? And about four people raised their hands. She then says, do you consider yourself fortunate, Mrs. Brown? Well, yes, I guess so. Do you consider yourself fortunate never to have been the victim of a crime, Mr. Smith? Well, yeah, I guess so. I guess I've just been lucky. Mrs. Spivis, have you been the victim of a crime? She says, well, there was this guy who flashed his on me by opening his trench coat. Do you consider yourself fortunate, was the next question. True story, I kid you not.
Did she get on the jury?
I don't remember. The other thing is I found some of the most effective questions are ones where you ask, you engage in a dialogue and have the juror problem solve. And here's an example. It's an employment case, and the lawyer says, I want you to imagine that you are the foreman of a factory, and there's been a big downturn in what widgets are selling for, and you're gonna have to lay some people off. How do you make that decision? Well, juror number one says, well, I think seniority matters, so the last one's in or the first one's out. Somebody else says, well, I think merit should have something to do with it. Mrs. Spivis, it's a different case. Mrs. Spivis in the back row says, well, I think we ought to get all the old people out because my son-in-law needs a job. Well, on an age discrimination case, you know you don't want Mrs. Spivis. Again, that's a true event in the courtroom. The people who do it well, I'd say, also share their own vulnerabilities. They engage in a dialogue and might admit things about themselves. Bias is one of those issues that comes up that I found if you make yourself vulnerable, that you can get information. And some lawyers are so good at it. I had a judge call me up once to say, Marsha, you gotta get down here. She's got them confessing to their extramarital affairs.
Yeah, that's bearing your soul. So real quick, because we're getting near on time, what's the least effective thing you see usually of attorneys? Judge Otake, we'll start with you.
I'm sorry, I didn't hear the question.
The least effective.
Oh. Need the most.
I think I already covered that. It's really not asking a question. the one thing that I also see a lot of is too much of a focus on trying to get the juror who's really going to be on your side 100%, rather than getting rid of the jurors who are going to be horrible for you. At the end of the day, and Bob and I have already had this discussion earlier, you're really actually deselecting, because unless you have an hour of time and you are, you know, the Michael Jordan of voir dire, you're not going to be able to get a jury of 12 people or a jury of 8 people who are going to be, you know, cheering for you during closing argument. So I think it's really crafting your questions in a way to figure out who's really going to hurt your case more than, you know, let me give you this scenario. I like Judge Pechman's example for sure. But most people are not that level good. I mean, most people, when they're coming up with scenarios, are kind of fumbling through them, coming up with an awkward fact pattern that is so obviously similar to their fact pattern. That's not terribly helpful. So I'd focus more on deselection than selection.
Judge Pechman, anything to add?
There are so many. The least effective thing, I think, is trying to indoctrinate the jury as to what the law is. Mrs. Spivis, what does beyond a reasonable doubt mean to you? I mean, come on, you didn't know that before you went to law school. Why should they? And so it's not gathering facts, it's indoctrination. And I think that's really not effective at all.
Judge Battaglia, we'll end with you.
Well, I agree with everything they've said. I mean, the least effective jury selection is usually someone that, I'll just call them the showboat. I tried a case years ago with a lawyer who had a photographic memory. memorized every member of the juror's name in the first 5 minutes of the case being called, and then went on to show off with that ability, turned the jury completely off. They said to us after, that guy was a buffoon, was a showman. So yes, you are a salesperson, right, of your client's case. You are the advocate, but don't become the show person, the showboat. And that's a lot of preening goes on in voir dire that I think turns the jury off. They want someone they feel is going to be square, going to be, you know, tell it like it is, be truthful with them. That's the bond you want to create, that I'm here to present my client's case and I'm going to give it to you straight. That's what they really want to feel in the end.
Thank you.
So we're going to move into our breakout sessions now. And this is one of the most important parts of this presentation, is to get the collective wisdom of the audience. So I would ask, if you're not at a table that is completely full, to find one and fill it in. And we are going to take the next 20 minutes till about 3:10 to allow you as a group to discuss amongst yourselves not only the comments that the judges have given you, but for some of the topics that we have up here that we just haven't had a chance to fully vet. And one of them is the pros and cons of utilizing Zoom for picking a jury in federal court. We haven't talked about Zoom and its impact on that, but it's been a big deal over the last couple of years. So if that's a topic you want to talk about at your table, that's great. If there are other topics that we've raised, but the real hope is that over the next 20 minutes that you'll collectively talk with one another, and then we'll spend the last 20 minutes of the presentation really coming up and sharing our thoughts with the judges and to see if we can get any other comments from them on the issues. Thank you. Okay, we're gonna start our breakout table presentations now. So Robert, why don't you start with the tables and a table captain? And the goal here is to try, we only have 20 minutes, but we're gonna try to get to as many tables as possible. If we'd really welcome a few comments that you discussed that you thought would be important for the group to hear, and then we have our three judges that can comment from any of the feedback we get from the tables. Robert?
We had quite a vibrant discussion at our table. But what we got was that we found Zoom jury selection quite convenient and helpful. And there's reports of that in King County, Washington, where virtually all voir dire is conducted on Zoom. But some pushback there was that there was concerns regarding the process being quite, not so much interpersonal ability to build rapport with the juror. And some of us thought that individual questionnaires were not helpful because someone's filling it out outside the courtroom and they're not really, you're not really getting the right answers, you know. And the best place for them to answer these questionnaires are in the courtroom when they're, you know, in front of a judge, in front of the lawyers. Some of us thought that jury consultants were actually helpful. They were worth more than a spit.
So let me start off with the judges here about the pros and cons of utilizing Zoom for picking a jury in federal court. Maybe Judge Pechman, you could bat lead off on this one.
Okay, well, I've been called the Zoom queen more than once because Western District of Washington was the first district to do it. The district did over 30 civil trials. I personally did 13, both bench and jury selection. So the things that I would say about Zoom jury selection is that we had huge responses to our summons. We had like 85% to 90% of people responding. And if there's another judge in the room that can beat those numbers for people responding to summonses, I don't know where it would be. The other thing is we found we got a more diverse, at least economically diverse, jury pool. Part of that is because we were only using jurors 5 hours a day. It's a big district. People didn't have to come by train, plane, ferry in order to get to the courthouse. I think that overall the lawyers who did it, what I found is anybody who doesn't like it hasn't tried it. And the lawyers who tried it wound up thinking that they knew more about the jurors than they would in a regular voir dire. And the reason was is you could see people in their homes. You could see the guy that had his degrees on the wall behind the desk. You could see the mom who was sitting in the laundry room because that was the only quiet place to be found. And you could actually see them better. I had one juror say, the last time I was on jury duty, I was 35 feet away. I could barely see anybody in the witness box. So I went out and measured my courtroom. It was 35 feet away. We also gave them more time because we did 8 jurors at a time. So if it's access of the public to be able to participate, and if we have a way that we also don't over call people that we're not going to use, it's a tremendous cost savings to everyone. I think it puts more pressure on the judge to warm up the jury, give them permission to talk with one another when they're in the breakout room. And Tom, what was the question that I asked them to talk about one day in your trial?
So I had the pleasure, I think, of being your fourth, maybe your fifth Zoom trial, and it was near Thanksgiving. And Judge Pechman, to her credit, I think weren't you talking about like Thanksgiving recipes?
Yes. So I was hoping to produce a cookbook. That didn't happen, but.
No, but Judge Pechman really raises a great point. And before we move on to other questions, Judge, I wanted you just to give maybe your perspective on litigants' access to court. You gave an example to me that was very touching, and I think everyone would benefit from your wisdom on that part.
I had some litigants who never would have been able to be at their trials in civil cases. One example was there was a homeless man who was living out of his car, and he was struck by a U.S. Postal Service truck. And it was a bench trial. And at the time of the collision, the man had his two dogs with him. He refused going to the hospital in the ambulance because he didn't have any place for his dogs. That man lost his home, his car, and he went out on the peninsula in Washington and he lived in a tent from then on with his dogs. He did make it into his doctor's appointments, driving the car that was really not roadworthy, 100 miles round trip to see his doctors. At the time of trial, his lawyer went into the woods to get him and brought him to his office with his two dogs. And I can say this gentleman had some real mental health issues, and his dogs were a true comfort to him. So I'm trying this case, and all of a sudden I hear this dog, and you know, his lawyer is going, you gotta keep the dogs quiet, you gotta keep the dogs quiet. And I had to say, counsel, that's my dog. But anyway, it was a real icebreaker with the litigant. And he then was able to testify. He could have not gotten into the courthouse. That would have been too frightening. And what he told me is all he wanted me to give him is the means to sleep somewhere with a door. Zoom allowed him to be able to say that. In the courtroom would have been way too intimidating. And would I have had the wisdom to let him bring the dogs? Maybe not.
Good point.
He did. Or at least he got the money to buy himself a place.
Probably a few doors.
Judge Otake, any comments?
I have not tried it myself. Judge Pechman is making me want to try it, though, and willing to try it. I'm curious to know, Judge Pechman, if you ran into any technical difficulties with any of the potential jurors. And the reason why I ask is I've had a lot of technical difficulties with Zoom hearings for attorneys, with attorneys, and it's not, I honestly don't think it's always their fault. I think it's just, you know, the Wi-Fi gods didn't shine down upon them that day,
yeah.
You know, and so, especially when we have a lot of rural areas of our state on the other islands and what have you, I was curious to know whether or not you had that difficulty.
The answer was yes. You know, we had a big storm, and one of our jurors out in the rural area had a tree come down, and her husband, they lost electricity. Her husband got the generator going. She got in the car to go to the library where she could get a connection. By the time we got that done, the electricity was back on, and, you know, we lost some time. I actually kept track of this in terms of how much time we lost with outages, freeze-ups, that sort of thing. And you know, it wasn't much different than somebody missing the bus, somebody not being able to get through security, the witness who was late. None of the witnesses were late, by the way. And so, you know, it happens, but it evens out. In every trial, you're going to lose some time, but there were just different losses of time. We did deliver equipment that was owned by the court to some people whose stuff didn't work for them. We delivered a hotspot. You know, and I was quite confident we were going to get our stuff back. After all, we knew where they lived. So it worked out.
Judge Battaglia.
Well, I'm not a fan. Sorry, Judge Pechman. I grew up as a trial lawyer for 20 years, having success relating to juries, and I felt I always related well to them in three dimension. In my later career as a reformed lawyer doing seminars and talking to the Hollywood Squares during the COVID in seminars, I didn't get the same connection with my audience that I got. And if I'm going to make opening statements and closing arguments and jury selection, I want to see the whites of their eyes. I want to feel the vibes. Am I selling it? Am I not? And this is purely a personal view, because I think there's very valid and good uses for Zoom in the bench trial, in the Rule 43 example of having a participant, witness, or whatever being there. But for a true trial lawyer at heart, I want them in front of me where I can smell them and I can see them and I can see how they recoil when I say something, or they're sitting apart from their colleagues. There's just so much to be gained in the third dimension that I'm prejudiced. I would have to be struck from the jury on Zoom trials.
You're not getting off this jury that quick.
Let me ask this. Have you tried it?
I have not tried it because of my...
I rest my case.
Well, I haven't, but it's not without having reflected on it. I have had bench trials by Zoom. I have had witnesses testify remotely, but my own experience as a trial lawyer was I want them in person, and that's how I carry it, because I can into my day job. Yeah. But I respect Judge Pechman's views and her experience with it. I just disagree. Hey,
moving on. All right, who's an expert over here? Who's an expert at this table? Who's going to talk? Go on, let's go.
Bob, there was a table over there. I think it's the next table over where Corey Endo is seated. And there was a woman
so
on that
mean.
Table. Who
so
had,
mean, but you're the judge.
I'm not calling on Corey. but
somehow you got the short end of the stick.
There's a woman there who I thought had a very interesting suggestion about questionnaires that I had never thought of before. So I'd like her to mention it if she doesn't mind.
I was involved as a defense lawyer with a gang-related case last summer, and in our jury questionnaire, I proposed in the question about gangs, to elicit some fact, have the veneer check off the boxes for the statements they agreed with. So the statements were, I am a member of a gang. I was a member of a gang. I have family members who are gang members. I have family members who were gang members. I went to school with gang members. I grew up in a neighborhood with gang members. I was victimized by a gang. And just so there were a lot of these factual statements, they could check off whichever ones applied, and then there was a narrative section underneath if they wanted to follow up on that. And we did that for several of the questions to try and prompt the veneri to think about the context in which they might be able to have had actually report experiences in these different areas.
How did you feel that worked for you as an attorney?
Well, I have to say, with the number of questionnaires we had set up a spreadsheet and were able to just check off boxes for the ones that were checked as affirmative, they'd had that kind of contact, rather than trying to somehow assimilate anything that was in the narrative section and then be able to compare it. So visually, it was much easier to go ahead and deal with all these questionnaires.
Interesting. Yeah. Very interesting.
Okay. Is any other group ready? We've done two.
I'll come over, Robert.
You go.
Hello. Our table has three districts, I think, Eastern District of California, District of Nevada, and District of Arizona. And I obviously can't elaborate on all the discussion given time constraints, but I thought one interesting discussion point was whether or not the judges would ask the voir dire questions themselves or have the attorneys do that. And then kind of as an overlay to that, there was a discussion about whether there's any tension with attorneys and judges on that point and whether the attorneys preferred to ask the questions. And there was one comment that I thought was really insightful, which I thought the response would be the attorneys would for sure want to ask all the questions, but one of the attorneys said, you know, I like it when the judges ask the questions so then that I can watch the jury and it takes, you know, read the room and get more of an impression of what's going on, and it allows me to listen to the answers better. So I thought, just given the overlay of the discussion on and the survey results for tension for judges and jury, that was an interesting kind of middle ground. And I think all of the districts here, most of the judges ask the questions. It varies by judges somewhat, and then sometimes the judges will allow the attorneys to ask follow-up questions, but for the most part, it seems for our districts, the judges ask the questions. So I thought the discussion earlier was interesting where, you know, make yourself vulnerable. We just rely on our judges to do that. It makes it easier.
All right. Any comments from the judges? Okay, we're next.
Thank you, everyone. My name is Theo Angelis. I'm from the Western District of Washington. I had the pleasure of being at a table primarily with district court judges from the District of Arizona who had very interesting thoughts that I thought I would share. Forgive me. I just assumed. But a couple of things that were brought up that were very helpful. One of the judges has a standing order regarding social media, and all sort of agreed that it is the standard of practice for attorneys to use social media to understand their veneer and the individual potential jurors. But there was a lot of concern to make sure that both sides would have the ability and the resources to take advantage of it. And so there should be some requirement that if social media is going to be used, that there are strict ground rules and that both sides have the opportunity to fairly examine. And to that end, there was some talk about questionnaires and how to use them effectively. It seemed like all of the judges at our table had the questionnaires come in significantly in advance of the trial, either a month or as few as 3 days, but enough time so that the attorneys could use them. And one of the judges talked about a practice that she has where the attorneys get together with the answered questionnaires and decide in advance whether this will be an automatic disqualification, a sort of likely, but maybe we need a little bit of follow-up, or this should not be grounds for disqualification unless more facts are developed. So those were very useful, and they kind of go to some of the things that our panelists talked about with respect to making sure that there's enough time to actually use the questionnaires that are asked for.
Yeah, great.
We probably have time for one more, Robert.
Okay. Who else is ready? One more lucky group. Oh, look at that.
Shamed into it. Hi, I'm from the Eastern District of California. We had a very interesting discussion with our judges regarding how to try and limit the number of requests for hardships. And two of our judges asked the litigants to give the counsel to give a mini opening statement to the whole veneri 3 to 5 minutes on each side. This is not something I'd ever heard of before. And the pitch from the judges is the more interesting you are in giving your opening statement, the less likely it is that someone's going to be asked, that someone wants to be excused. And they also do, as Judge Pechman suggested, to ask for hardships at the end of that process. And they think that it reduces greatly the number of folks that try and wiggle out of jury service. Interesting.
What are Your Honor's thoughts on giving a little mini opening, like a 2 to 3 minute opening? Would you be open to that?
What was the question?
Whether you'd be willing to allow them to do a 2 or 3 minute opening.
I favor the standard or the joint statement. I think it's more efficient and it avoids any, there's no coefficient for mistake or error.
I'd do it if in a civil case if the attorneys agreed to it. Give it a shot.
Judge Pechman?
Hey, I'm willing to try just about anything.
So the Zoom queen's going to let a mini opening go too? So,
you know, I have seen it work, particularly if you want, you know, many times people want to bifurcate. And, you know, I have seen it done where you give mini, mini statements on each stage of your bifurcation. But I haven't seen it done for voir dire. But it's the same principle that if you get them interested, they don't want to go out the door. Whether the judge does that, you know, with a neutral statement or the questioning, you know, it's a technique.
Well said. Let's give a few thank yous before we wrap up. Could I have Cynthia Jones stand up and Roger Townsend, our two organizers? Let's give them a round of applause. Let's give a round of applause to Bob Fona, and then to our three judges, Judge Pechman, Judge Otake, and Judge Battaglia. Thank you for your wisdom and comments today. Very appreciated. Thank you, everyone.